Ran and Silma, I appreciate what you said, that you guys re-elected me because I was doing a good job. 6 months from now, I'm going to come calling, and I hope for the same thing. So, but it's a pleasure and an honor to represent this amazing community that I grew up in, and we worked together, in fact. It's 20 years ago, actually. When I had a consulting company and worked with the CPI on their strategy for foreign trained professionals, and started from very humble beginnings, and look at the work that you are now doing on behalf of the community. So I really want to commend you, Silma, for your leadership and for the work that you're doing. The last time I was here, we were here with Cisco. Was it not with Cisco? And almost 100% of the graduates of that program had moved into new economy technology jobs. It was amazing talking to them about transitioning their career into tech. And it was so interesting. So for those of you who have clients who want to get into tech, either engage in that program or connect with each other, because there's such a high demand. We know that our economy and our workplaces are in constant change, right? We know that. In fact, there's so much disruption happening in the economy right now that we don't know what it's going to look like in a decade from now. Just like how we didn't know what the jobs were going to be a decade ago or 20 years ago. But what we do know is that people in our communities need to have access to meaningful, good jobs, and that people who live, and we're both, Tracy and I, are here represented by local communities. I'm here as the employee
of Scarborough,
and I want the people in my community to have access to good jobs, to have access to meaningful work, so that they can live and work and thrive in this community. And that's what we want to see happen. So I am just, you know, the reason I got into politics is that I wanted to make a difference and to create change. That's what has always driven me, my whole career. And this is a change. What we're talking about is a game changer for people. What we're talking about is a game changer for people who live in this community, who work so hard. So many people, and you know this, because you know how hard your clients are working. They have more than one job. Sometimes even three jobs to make ends meet, right? So by having
have you signed it yet?
A raise to the minimum
wage, it's a sign-in chain.
That's going to give them more options, right? So if there's more dollars in their pocket, it's going to give them more options. So, and that's not all that Bill 148 is about. It's also about just having a revamp to our employment system, because it's long overdue, and I know that you know that. So we need an employment system that is fair to workers and that respects workers and for the contribution that they make. So I'm happy to announce that Bill 148 has received royal assent, and our government's plan to create opportunities, security, and fairness for all workers is now law. So, you know, I just want to touch on some of the progressive initiatives that are covered in Bill 148. We will raise the minimum wage, as I said, to $15 an hour by January 1st, 2019. There is no delay. We're not promising a delay over years and years and years. We're saying people deserve fairness now, or as of January, less than a month today, people will be getting extra
$1.60,
right? $1.60. Oh my goodness, we can't even calculate it. They'll be getting an extra $3
$2.40.
$2. Oh, is that people? I don't think getting an extra $2.40. Right? $10. Right?
Get the phone out.
Okay. Right? That's bread on the table. That might even be some quality time that you don't have to eat. Right? So that's key important. I know you know that. So that is happening. We will also make sure that part-time and temporary health agency workers receive equal pay for doing the same work as full-time employees. So I know you know the importance of cleaning up the time. So people will be getting their wages or their days work. We will be making scheduling fairer and more flexible. And if I ever are there any business owners here? Business owners? Okay. Maybe we didn't invite them. That's okay. You know, we want our businesses to do well, but I have to say this is where I receive the most complaints from businesses. They just don't want to do it. Well, you know what? People have lives. They need dignity. Work access is actually about dignity. It's about being proud of earning your paycheck. So scheduling is important to that, so you can have some predictability and normalcy to your life. So we put that into the things. Even work from you where it works.
You heard about it. Mm-hmm.
We're giving all employees across the province up to 10 personal leave days a year, including 2 paid days, so that they can take time that they need when they need it. Maybe one of their children who, you know, unfortunately become ill. They need that time. Okay. So that will be reflected so that they can take the time as they need it without fear of losing. Minimum vacation entitlement will be increased to 3 weeks of paid vacation a year after you've been working on the state. Lots of time. Rest is important. We're giving people affected by domestic and sexual violence 17 weeks of job protected leave, including. And, you know, I just want to salute my colleague, Tracy McCloud, for the work that she has done on sexual violence and harassment laws in this province, making it just a better society for people to be free from sexual violence and harassment. Thank you for that. Thank you. And finally, I will increase enforcement so workers' rights are protected, and this will also level the playing field so that businesses who follow the rules are not at a competitive disadvantage with those who are not. So overall, our work is to make Ontario a fairer place for all, right? And I want you to know that this is what you so yes, we have concerns. Yes, technology is disruptive. Yes, all of these things are challenging. But we are a government that's committed to this. Right? Last time I was also here, I talked about the renewal side, right? And free tuition. Well, that's already in place. Over 250,000 students are now benefiting from the renewal side. Right? Getting free tuition. I was just speaking with adult educators, people with adult learners, and there's been a 20% increase in adult learners going on to the second grade as a result of the business. Right? Because there's no age limit. So that's what you can count on us for as a government. Okay, so I just want to say, while I have the opportunity, thank you for the work on behalf of people, certainly in this community. You know the needs. There's tremendous needs in this community. this policy is going to make my so I'm just really honored to hear all of you for your work. And at this time, I want to introduce my dear friend and colleague who was there on day one. And she does a fantastic job in her community. She's so well respected and well regarded for the work that she does. And we all admire her for her strength and her courage, physical strength. So I'm happy to introduce Tracy Charles. Hi everyone. It's great to be here with all of you and my wonderful colleague, Mitzi Hunter. Our ridings are right next to each other. I represent Scarborough East as well as Pickering in the current boundaries. That's all changing next year, but I'm really happy to represent part of Scarborough as well, part of the Scarborough team along with our other colleagues, because it's my hometown. I grew up in West Hill and went to West Hill Collegiate. And, you know, when I think about Bill 148 and what our government's doing here, I can't help but think about my friends and family growing up in Scarborough myself. So when my mom was a single mom, she worked part-time at the Scarborough General Hospital. She would take the bus up there. She worked in the office, the admitting office. And I think she got paid minimum wage. But, you know, it was always a long day, rotating shifts, taking that bus along Lawrence Avenue. And then when my sister and I got a little older, we worked part-time at Scarborough Town Center. And we would go there after school and take two buses, right? We'd go along Lawrence to either McCowan or Grimley, and then take the second bus. And, you know, our shift was maybe 3.5 hours with retail. And I always felt for my sister. She was a little bit younger. And she didn't get paid very much. She didn't get paid very much for the work she did. So I'm so glad to see that this legislation also includes progressive increases for students and young people under 18. It's so important. And when I was in Newport University, I worked downtown. I worked on a summer employment program for $3.25, I think. But I had to work at night. So I'd go downtown. I worked in the Attorney General's office, and I earned my $3.25 an hour on a summer experience program. But I needed another job. I had to go back to Scarborough Town Center at night and work to be able to save for my tuition. And it was tough. It was tough. And, you know, these wage increases, I think, are going to make a real difference to people in our community. And I want to thank all of you, as this has done too, for the work you do in our community, frontline agencies, many of you, I know your organizations from my work, as Missy mentioned, as a women. Minister in Ontario for a couple of years. I did sexual violence harassment action plan. And now in my current role as Minister of Government Services and Consumer Services, but especially accessibility. I know accessibility touches the work that you all do, and that's what I'm going to talk to you about in us after this. But I just want to say thank you, you know, for the work that you do day in day out in Scarborough and beyond. Because you're the front line. You deal with people in our community, you support people in our community, you make a positive difference, and I know you work together too, right? You're not siloed, you work across the system too, and that's so important. So, I, like Mitzi, very excited about this announcement today that it's really law. This is actually happening. This isn't something for a law, it's actually happening. And it allows us to do more too. It allows people in the community, when they earn more, to spend more, right? So it's good for the economy. It's helpful, you know, in personal households, but spending more for the economy is good for jobs. And because we balanced our budget, we're able to do these kinds of things. The Bill 148 we're talking about today, or other things that we're acting on because we balanced our budget, whether it's a free tuition, as you mentioned, expanded child care. Free prescription drugs for anyone under 25 years old as of January 1st. My kids are under 25, and so all they have to do is take that
prescription to the pharmacy, 4,400 drugs are covered. It doesn't matter what your family's benefits or not. It doesn't matter if you're a student like my kids. It's free. It's absolutely free. It's fantastic. They also have other things going on around a basic income pilot you probably heard about, and our Fair Hydro plan, and our Fair Housing plan. So, again, balancing our budget allows us to take action on all these other things that affect people every day, but I'd say positively affect businesses. So what I say to business, this is good for you. All of this is good for you. More spending power, good for the economy, that's more jobs, and it's great for businesses. And it helps build Ontario up. So unfortunately, we know other parties in the legislature are not as supportive or not at all supportive in terms of where they stand. And unfortunately, the leader of the opposition would rather not raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour. And he doesn't believe that all workers should get paid sick days. He doesn't believe in providing relief for victims of domestic and sexual violence. So that's what's unfortunate. So we know, Missy and I don't have to tell you, it's like we're talking to the converted here today. We know that the government's approach would be more people in Scarborough, whether you're people are living in poverty, whether you're neighbors, colleagues, you know, struggling to pay bills or put food on that table. We know that this is gonna make a positive difference. And we also know that the program will help the economy, and that's good for everyone. So greater quality, of course, is a necessity for a strong economy. And we want to have more money in the hands of our Ontarians, for ourselves, for families, and the community. And by creating more economic strength for individuals, you're restricting that economy too. So the cost of doing nothing for us is simply not an option. Like, it just, the cost is too high, right? To do nothing would cost us in so many ways, economically and socially as well. So the values and the foundation of Bill 148 think define us as Ontarians, as people who live in Scarborough. And we need to create the kind of opportunity for young people right here to feel confident about their future. And for older workers too, it's just about young people. But our older workers need to be respected and protected. We saw the article I saw the other day about older workers working multiple part-time jobs to make ends meet, right? They, maybe they want to do that. Maybe they don't. Maybe with an appropriate wage, they can find that right balance, right, of earning an income and enjoying the retirement they so richly deserve. So, we know it's a different workplace, as Missy mentioned. I think what we have here is something that strikes that right balance for employers, for Ontarians, and all of Scarborough. And I just want to say thank you so much for having us here today. It's always great to do an event with Missy and all of you right here in Scarborough. And keep on doing the fantastic work you do. And thank you to TCPI for hosting us today, because I know it takes a bit of work to put these events on, so I think we should give them a round of applause. Oh, so I think with that, back to the host. And oh, I should mention too, if you didn't get it, Emily and some Mitzi's team have news releases here. This is a nice couple of pages, and it gives you all the highlights that Mitzi and I talked about today. I haven't got one here available yet. I want to thank you, Tracy, for just flushing that out for us a bit so that we can understand that and see the impact this will have. And now I would like to invite Corey Sinclair, who is one of the participants from our youth program, this is the work experience program. And say a few words about how this is the system in his future.
Good morning.
paparazzi.
Minimum wage raising up to $14 and $15 in 2019. It really helps young adults like myself come further on in life while moving out. And some people my age or older start families on their own. With the minimum wage now, most people aren't able to do that. They really don't have the incentive to get jobs because the minimum wage right now is really low. So with it raising up more, you have more younger adults, have more incentive to want to go out to look for jobs. So they have a higher chance at purchasing houses or renting so they can move forward on with their lives, do whatever they want to do. For me personally, I feel that it's really good that the minimum wage is rising because my future career is in police foundations. I really want to be a correctional officer. That's my career. And the minimum wage rising is giving me more incentive to move out, focus more on going to school with the OSAP now coming free from legal. It's giving more students to further their education to go on with their lives. And basically do what they need to do, pursue their goals and dreams. So really, I'm really grateful for you doing this today and talking because this is a really powerful topic for young people like myself. And it's just everything that most adults really hope for you since that they were really a bunch. They know what to do. Now they really have really clear insight on what they have to do.
And now I'd like to invite Neil Cassius from the school board the next step and bring district safety workers and service providers like you.
Hi, good morning, everybody. I'm a supervisor at the Next Steps Employment Center, and we are the frontline staff, and I will speak on behalf of a lot of service providers. There's two big challenges that we face. Number one is the people that come looking for work. They don't want to work for a living change if they can't live on a living change. Toronto has become, as we all know this, one of the most expensive cities in the world. It's not a livable wage that can change. So once this goes into play, people that are working, they're going to get a bigger paycheck, or people that are unemployed, right? There's going to be a lot bigger incentive for them to go into work. Because now people can actually pay their bills and pay the second biggest challenge we face is employers. And employers, then, you know, they have an interesting dilemma. They come to us sometimes and they can't find people. And I ask them, why can't you find people? I know what the answer is. What are you paying them? Well, it's 11 and change. Well, why don't you pay them more? You can't find people at 11 and change. So I know there's a lot of the small business community is saying that what they're going to see is they're going to benefit from it as well. If they're going to get better staff, they're going to have people that actually have more money that they're going to spend. I know for myself, when I get more money, I spend more money. That's the way it goes. So I wouldn't worry too much about that. Several years ago, I lived in Australia. That time they had $15 an hour. And their economy was doing just great. And I was in Switzerland a few years ago and they were it's a lot higher. They're doing just great. So we're gonna do just great. So I wanna thank you for having the courage to do the right thing. Thank you for not making us race to the bottom. Best countries in the world pay for help. So thank you very much.
for keeping us informed on significant change to the leader. It is my belief that this change was significantly greater systemic living for honest currently with property, those that are classified as what it is a great opportunity for us as service providers to use this information to help to educate our employers that we're working with about the changes to the labor law and to provide them with some support in creating their policies. It's very important that they step up to the plate and update their policies so that they're adhering to this new law. And we became aware of that. So we work very closely with the employers. And further, it is also essential for us to keep our clients informed about this change, because although this will come into law, a lot of our clients are not going to know this. And there are those few employers that will try to take advantage of our clients. And so it's important that we educate not just the employers, but also our clients. We all have a role in educating employers in ensuring fairness and workplace integrity. So let's do our part in supporting Itzy and Tracy.
We want to do a good job.
So we're going to help them in doing this. And now I'd like to open the floor for questions and answers. So let's go on. Thank you for questions.
Are there any questions? Or can we ask them?
Selma, yeah, Mitzi, sorry, Minister Hunter, when you were talking about, I just wanted to ask a little bit more about the temporary help agencies, which we all know are merchants of misery, and I mean, it's awful. You can quote that, yeah, Marie, yeah, okay. When they're paying their staff $12 an hour, but they're billing the employer $32 an hour. So what does this this change about that? Can you explain that a little bit?
So my understanding, and if you have more details on this, is that they are required by law to harmonize what they pay their permanent staff with their agency staff.
Okay.
So
okay.
That's where the change is.
Yeah. Okay.
I can give you an example. My son just started a security job working at the Scarborough, Birch Mountain, and General Sites.
Yeah.
And he works for an agency, a big security agency, and so he's, you know, not making a lot of money right now. He just graduated from Police Foundations. He has the same aspirations as he is. This is where he's starting. And exactly what Mitzi said. So come January 1st, they're going to have to put his wage. It's like, yes, you work for an agency, but at the end of the day, you're an employee. And you are entitled to the same rights as any other employee to the minimum standards under the Employment Standards Act. So it is a change for the agencies, but it is time for them to do that. And I would say I'd like to see them rebalance more, because I can see that with my son's.
Oh, absolutely.
Because you know how to get that piece for the agency, and then sort of the minimum piece for the staff.